thank you all for coming out here on what is now literally the eve of spring break. Very much appreciate it. We've had a really enjoyable day of events. I think some of you, I'm sure, were at the lecture at noon, which was a whole lot of fun, and maybe you've caught some of the classes and things that we've been hanging out in today, and it's been a great deal. So this is the first event of what we hope will be a series that takes place semester after semester in the coming years, called the Connections Series. The idea is to showcase the reality that human knowledge and the human experience is not something that's easily boxed up into disciplinary boundaries. Biology does not end at the Department of Biology's door. History doesn't end at Marcia Hall. That all of these things are connected. And there are a lot of ways, if we want to understand the truly complicated reality that is the human experience, we really have to look to interdisciplinary approaches and transdisciplinary approaches and really kind of look to see the connections that exist. So for our first event for this, what we wanted to do was to bring two scholars in, rather than the kind of traditional model that we followed in the past with lecture series where we just bring one person, to bring two people with different backgrounds but overlapping backgrounds who are interested in the same problem. So earlier today we had historian Jim Fleming talking about the history of efforts to change climate across time, and it was really exciting. The one really disturbing thing for me is that I'm a cyclist, and during the winter I have to train in my basement, and I watch bad movies. And I have watched all four Sharknado films over the past few weeks. And I watch these things, and you've probably seen Sharknado, and you're like, oh my God, this is, oh, no one, this is ridiculous, oh my God, throwing dynamite in the tornado, whatever. Well, listening to Jim's talk, it turns out that people have tried it, which is crazy. No sharks, so far as I know, involved in weather, but as it continues, well, who knows. So, anyway. So this evening, what we have is Cameron Wake, not the defensive end for the Miami Dolphins. Instead, on Twitter, he is known as the Climate Doctor. He is Joseph A. Lamprey Professor of Climate and Sustainability at the University of New Hampshire. He leads a research group exploring regional climate change through analysis of ice core records and instrumental data. And he engages in an extensive range of outreach and efforts to communicate the realities of climate change. He's also involved in activism and involved in Carbon Solutions New England, which looks at ways to address the challenges facing us. So without further ado.
Thank you, Eric. Hopefully this mic works. That's good. I've got dueling mics. I've never done that before, so we're proof that an academic can deal with technology. It's been great. It's been a wonderful day to be here, actually, and meet students and faculty from different departments and really sort of explore this issue of climate change from at least two, but I think more than two, different disciplines. So I'm going to kind of be the science of climate change guy, but at the end I talk about solutions, which are, I would say, fall much more in the social science realm of the challenge than the science realm of this challenge. I am the climate doctor, and I want you to follow me because I've been told that the more followers I have, the better. I'm trying to catch up to Eric, who's a rock star for academics and followers. How many followers do you have, Eric?
20,500.
Yeah, I'm at just over 1,000, so I got a long way to go. All right, so I'm going to start with a premise, and that is, climate change is the most significant grand challenge society faces in the 21st century. And I say that after thinking about this problem for 30 years. And the reason I think climate change is the most important is that it makes every other grand challenge more difficult or impossible to address. So let's look at a few of those. You might think that childhood hunger is the most significant grand challenge we face. Childhood hunger and food security, right? 1 in 5 children in America is food insecure. And that ratio increases significantly when you look around the world. So as our population grows from 7 billion to 9 billion people through this century, maybe 10 billion people. We're going to have more mouths to feed, and it's going to be more difficult to feed those people because in the area where most people live, in the tropics, we're going to have an increase in the number of big storms, big flooding events, big droughts, hot temperatures and heat waves, all things that are going to stress crops that make it more difficult to grow that food to feed that population. So you might think that national security is the most important grand challenge that we face. One that is certainly going to be made more difficult by the issue of climate change. And the best way to research this is to go to a series of papers that the Pentagon put out in 2014. They always do this quadrennial defense review. They did several other papers, too, and Chuck Hagel was leading the Pentagon then, Department of Defense, that talk about climate change as a threat multiplier. Climate change that increases environmental degradation, increases social tensions, and increases political stability, making it more difficult to remain secure. And in fact, there have been several scholars that have written papers recently suggesting that the current conflict in Syria was actually sparked by the issue of drought through the Middle East. I think there's still some debate there, but it's certainly worthy of consideration in that the ground dried up, people couldn't grow their crops, they moved to the cities, we had sort of this Arab Spring, and now we're dealing with that Syrian conflict. You might argue that actually preserving our biodiversity is the most significant grand challenge, this incredible gift that has been given to us. 3 billion years of evolution on planet Earth, a really rapid increase in that rate of evolution over the course of the past 570 million years. This thing that is unique and precious and treasured, it has suffered in the past, right? In our history, we've had 5 major extinction events, whether from a meteorite impact or from glaciers covering the globe. But we are now in the midst of the 6th great extinction right now, first initially driven by land use change, essentially cutting down forests to grow crops, and now increasingly driven by climate change. So preserving our biodiversity right now is in fact a grand challenge, and one that we are unlikely to address in any significant way because of the issue of climate change. And you might think that preserving public health is the most significant grand challenge that we have, again, here and around the country. One that's going to be made more difficult to impossible, because in a warmer world, we expect the expansion of vector-borne disease, like dengue fever, like malaria, like our particular cross to bear in New England, Lyme tick disease. We're going to see the spread of those diseases around the world. We can also, warmer temperatures are going to lead to poor air quality. They're going to lead to heat waves that actually decrease public health. Warmer temperatures, foodborne illness, waterborne illness. There's lots of challenges in protecting public health in a world that's warmed by greenhouse gases. So all of these are more difficult. So with that as our framework, I want to share sort of 3 things that I want you to leave from my lecture today. And we can have a discussion about this and questions. One is that climate changes. Climate always has changed and climate always will change, right? And we study this as climatologists. We actually know why the climate system changes, and I teach a whole class on that, and we can get into those details. But I want you to know is that now, the difference today is that humans are the main driver of that change, right? There is an extensive and ever-growing body of scientific evidence that shows that humans are the main driver of that change. In fact, there was a recent paper that came out from an MIT researcher that investigated, well, how much consensus is there in the climate science community? You might have heard this number, 97% of climate scientists agree that humans are changing the climate system. Nod your head if you've heard that. Yeah, a little bit. So this guy from MIT looks at all of the publications in 2013 and 2014, and found that out of the, 6,000 plus publications in sort of, the premier journals, 24,000 authors, there were 4 papers which did not agree with the fact that humans are the main drivers of climate change. So that 97% is actually 99.99% of all people who publish in the peer-reviewed climate literature, right, acknowledge that humans are the main driver of the change. There's really, it's like science has answered the question. There's lots of other questions about climate change, but there is no doubt in the scientific study that humans are now the main driver of that change. And once you accept that, you have to agree with the following statement, that the future climate is literally in our hands. The climate that your children and grandchildren inherit depends fundamentally on the decisions we make today and over the next decade about how we produce and how we use energy. right? The future climate is literally in our hands. We're talking today about Richard Alley, who's an ice core paleoclimatologist, has done this great series of videos and called Earth, the Operator's Manual. It's that we're now in charge. We need to figure out, right, what our future climate's going to be and what we want. And that's not such an easy task. And you can see that there's, hopefully you'll see there's behavioral changes. And Jim talked today about some pretty massive, big picture technical changes that he made a good case on why we might not want to go down that pathway. All right, that's the first point. The second point is that I would argue that climate change is the innovation opportunity of the 21st century. And not just innovation in thin film technology for solar panels or wind turbines, but really innovations in every discipline or every sector of society, right? We need innovation in the way that we actually finance clean energy. We need innovation in universities. How is it that we can actually participate in this big experiment that we're doing right now to help guide decisions that we make in the future? We clearly need innovation in our government, which I would say is in a large part dysfunctional. So innovation really across a range of spectrums, and I'll talk a little bit about that. And the last point, which I won't dwell on too much today, but is something that I believe firmly in my soul now, is that climate change is a moral issue. And the reason is because it's those who are most vulnerable who are going to suffer the most. I would actually argue that all of you are going to be okay. You're all going to survive climate change. You're going to figure out how to adapt. But if you're young, or you're old, or you're sick, or you're poor, you probably don't have the options that you have to deal with the changing climate. And you know, a wonderful example of this is if you look at Hurricane Katrina or Superstorm Sandy, if you had resources, you got out of town, you figured it out. If you were in the hospital, if you were poor in New Orleans, you got stuck on that overpass with nowhere to go or in the Superdome. So it's very clear that it's true in this country, but it's also very true around the globe. It's those who are most vulnerable who are going to suffer the most. And I don't think that's a morally defensible position. The other way I think about this is when I drove up today, drove through a little snowstorm in my little car that gets 45 miles per gallon, I still emitted a bunch of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. And that's going to be warming climate for hundreds of years. So I get all the benefit of that, burning that fuel. But that impact starts today and is going to continue until your great-grandchildren are born. And I also don't think that's really morally defensible. We've talked, I mean, this country is sort of established on this notion that we will give a better life to our children. And giving them a world that's warmed by greenhouse gases is not accomplishing that. All right, so those are the three things I hope you leave with today. I'll talk a lot about the first two. So I am by training an ice core paleoclimatologist. I really love nothing more than being on a glacier with my crew and being in the mountains and drilling ice cores and then bringing them home and reconstructing our changing climate. I'm not going to talk a lot about my research, but I am going to share one seminal ice core record with you that if you actually want to know about climate change, you have to know about this record. And it comes from an Antarctic ice core, two of them actually, one drilled at Vostok and one drilled at Dome C. So as ice core paleoclimatologists, we go to these big flat glaciers. We like flat areas with nice horizontal layers. And we drill these cores and we go back in time, essentially, as we go deeper into the glacier. That picture up there, that's actually a picture of an ice core as viewed through cross polars. And you can see those sort of funky colors and hexagonal crystals represent the ice lattice. And then those blobs are bubbles of the atmosphere that are actually trapped in the ice. So as that snow transforms, as more snow falls on top of it, it gets buried and it turns to ice, there's air within those snowflakes that's captured in the ice itself. So you probably couldn't design a better system for storing a sample of the atmosphere and waiting for scientists to come back 800,000 years later and grab that sample and look at what the trace gas content of the atmosphere. It truly is remarkable. So those ice cores are crushed. We extract that air and we look at what the trace gas content of the atmosphere is. And here in the blue, I've plotted how the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere has changed over 800,000 years. Right? It's truly an amazing record. Hundreds of thousands of person hours to develop this record. Why do you care about carbon dioxide? It's a greenhouse gas. It actually acts like a blanket that you put on your bed on a cold winter's night like this Saturday is going to be. That blanket captures the long wave radiation coming from your body. Carbon dioxide captures the long wave radiation coming from the Earth. It's that simple. We figured out the physics 100 years ago. So you'll see that carbon dioxide has varied quite a bit over time. This bottom graph actually represents temperature in Antarctica that we measure from melting the ice and looking at stable isotopes. And the temperature at which that snow forms influences what the ratio between heavy oxygen and light oxygen is, and so we can, it's a proxy measure for how temperature has changed. And I hope after you've been looking at this image long enough that you can see that there's this fundamental dance between the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere and the temperature, right? When carbon dioxide is low, temperatures are low. When carbon dioxide is high, temperatures are high, right? There's this intricate relationship that really represents the rhythm of the Earth system. You'll note back here, when temperatures were low and carbon dioxide were low 18,000 years ago, we called that the last glacial maximum. There was nothing in New England at that time. There were no trees, lakes, mosquitoes, Native Americans, nothing, because it was covered with at least a mile of ice, if not more. So we've seen a tremendous amount of climate variability, or climate change, since the last glacial ice age until today. Tremendous. Sort of the waning of those ice sheets, the rising of sea levels. You'll also notice that there's been 8 cycles over the course of the past 800,000 years, right? So this is our current interglacial before that, interglacial going back in time. You'll see that there's 8 of those, and again, the temperature and the carbon dioxide line up pretty closely. So we have this cyclical change between ice ages and interglacial periods, and that's been driven by the changes in the Earth's orbit around the sun. And if you want to know more about that, I can talk about it, but I don't think I can do the Richard Alley dance. But essentially, the way that Earth's orbit changes, it changes the amount of solar radiation coming into the northern hemisphere that allows these big ice sheets to build up really slowly, right? Build up really slowly over time and then disintegrate really quickly. So you can see that there's a really nice seesaw pattern in here as well. Last but not least, you'll see that carbon dioxide has never been below 180 parts per billion, and it's never been above 300 parts per million by volume over the course of the past 800,000 years. So, enter human beings. Same record, I've just changed the axes so I can fit all of this data on here. Here we've got that carbon dioxide record. We start measuring carbon dioxide in Hawaii in 1957 as part of the International Geophysical Year. Charles Keeling convinces his Ph.D. advisor, Roger Revelle, that he's going to measure carbon dioxide in Hawaii. So first of all, beat that, right? Convince your Ph.D. advisor you're going to do your research in Hawaii. But he really starts an atmospheric observation program that continues to this day. Over that time, since 1957 to the present, we've increased the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere in an amount that's equivalent to a shift between a glacial to an interglacial age. Right? There's really no more information I need to show you to tell you that humans are dramatically changing the Earth's climate system. In fact, you might wonder why we haven't seen a much bigger response than we've seen already. So you can ask me that if you want to. The next step is, where are we going in the future? And if we continue to rely upon fossil fuels as our main source of energy, we are going to end up by the end of the century with carbon dioxide levels somewhere at 1,000 parts per million by volume. You know, maybe 1,200, maybe 1,300 parts per million by volume, maybe 800 parts per million by volume. A lot more carbon dioxide that I would argue is going to result in catastrophic climate change, and I'll tell you what I mean by that. Conversely, if we invest in energy efficiency and clean energy and preserve our natural resources and change our diets, we might be able to stabilize carbon dioxide in the atmosphere at 450 to 500 parts per million. There's an organization called 350.org. You might have heard of them. They want us to go back to 350 parts per million. That is a significant challenge and, you know, not something I think that's happening in the next several decades or maybe even 100 years. So we're already at 400 and we're continuing to rise in the atmosphere. So this is a challenge of your generation. That's where we're going and that's where we need to be. And my generation hasn't done a great job on this. We've laid the foundation to solve the problem, but we haven't solved the problem. It's your challenge, and you can say that's not fair, and I would agree with you, but that doesn't matter. This is a problem that needs to be challenged, and I think it's the youth of the world that can solve this, because I don't see my generation solving it. All right, a couple of other seminal records. I'm just going to bring you way back from that 800,000 years back to the last 100 years. You saw a portion of this graph if you were at Jim's talk today. His graph ended up in 19, 88 when James Hansen was testifying before Congress. But this is global atmospheric temperatures that we've put together based on measurements at the surface of the Earth. And you can really see that since 1970, we've just seen this continuous increase in temperature. 15 of the 16 warmest years have occurred since 2000. The 1 year that was out was 1997, that was an El Nino year, right? So we are continuing to warm the planet. Along with that warming planet, we're continuing to see this significant decline in the extent of Arctic sea ice. Why do you care about Arctic sea ice? It's the air conditioner of the Northern Hemisphere. Arctic sea ice is white, so it reflects incoming solar radiation right back out into space. When you remove that sea ice, you get ocean water that's dark, especially if the sun is overhead, and it's that sun can shine into the ocean, so it can warm a column of ocean. So that dark water warms up much more than the ice ever would, and that ocean is really good at storing that energy, making it really difficult for sea ice to reform, making it easier to get rid of more sea ice the next time around. So in a sense, Arctic sea ice is in this death spiral of there's almost less every year. That means there's more ocean water. That means there's more energy stored in the ocean, which means there's this ongoing reduction in the extent of sea ice. So you can see there's year-to-year variability. It depends on how warm the Arctic is. But we really had a bad year in 2007 and another really bad year in 2012. And most of the multi-year sea ice is now gone. And if you're interested, you'll have access to this. You can go and watch this video. And you can see how really almost all the sea ice now is 1 year old, where we used to have four-year-old sea ice that was 40 feet thick. Almost all of it now is one-year-old sea ice that's 10 to 15 feet thick. So it's highly vulnerable to really warm winters. What's really shocking this year, and if you've been paying any attention, you know this already, is that the Arctic sea ice never recovered in winter. So usually, right, the sun goes down, it gets dark, it gets really cold in the Arctic. So that didn't happen this year. Let me just see if I have this next figure in here. No, I'll just tell you this. So on Christmas Day, Arctic temperatures were 30 to 35 degrees above normal. Right? It was almost above freezing on Christmas Day at the North Pole. Unheard of. But as a result, that sea ice is not coming back. So this is just a record of December, January, February, March, April sea ice extent. The beige line represents the average. The green dashed line represents the last worst year, 2011, 2012. And you can see that this year we're way below that. Right? So if we have a warm summer next year in the Arctic, we're going to even see way more dramatic sea ice loss. And as I said, we're part of this vicious cycle now. Is that unlikely we're going to turn this around. We've probably already passed that threshold where Arctic sea ice disappears by the end of the summer, you know, within the next decade or two. And that's going to serve to warm up our climate. And there's several climatologists that are suggesting that the crazy weather that we're seeing, if you don't think we're having crazy weather, we can talk about that, but sort of these huge shifts from like really cold to like 70 degrees to really cold, is in part being driven by that reduction in sea ice and the reduction in the temperature gradient between the equator and the poles. So I can talk about that too. A couple of other key global trends before we talk about climate change in New England. This is another really cool data set. That's Greenland, a big ice cap on Greenland. It's got ice that represents about 20 feet of sea level rise. We've been really interested in how Greenland is changing as the world warms up. So what you're seeing in the colors here represents the surface velocity of ice on the Greenland ice sheet. And it's not measured by a bunch of guys or women driving around in skidoos and measuring poles, but it's measured using satellite imagery, a synthetic aperture radar, looking at how fast crevasses move across the surface. So it's a really impressive data set, and tremendous amount of work. And you can see that, you know, the green areas are pretty slow-moving ice, but these red areas are where ice is moving really quickly. And those are the big glaciers that drain the Greenland ice sheet. So they're moving on the order of 3,000 meters per year, or 3 kilometers per year, which for a massive piece of ice that would, you know, like take up most of the state of New Hampshire from the White Mountains down to the ocean, that's a really big deal. So I'm gonna show you some data from this one, Jakobshavn, which is a really well-studied glacier. in a nutshell, what's happening is that Jakobshavn and many others of those big outlet glaciers are changing their behavior and dumping way more ice into the Arctic Ocean. So here's a suite of measurements that show that. I know this is a really busy slide, so let me walk you through it. If you just focus on the red and the yellow data, that represents how fast the glacier has been moving at M9 and M5. So there's these two glaciers right very close to the snout of the Jakobshavn glacier. So this is their speed in meters per year, so divide by 1,000, you get kilometers per year. And this is a time series of how fast those sites have been moving from 1990 up to 2014. So if you look at the yellow and the red, it's moving fastest close to its snout. You know, back here it was moving 4,000 meters per year. That's pretty fast. In the mid-2000s, it was moving 8,000 meters per year. So it had doubled its velocity, which means essentially it's doubling the amount of ice that it's dropping into the North Atlantic. If you come down here in 2013 and 2014, we're now talking about 12,000 to 14,000 to 16,000 meters per year. So it's increased its velocity 3 to 4 times over the course of, 3 decades. It's fundamentally changing its behavior, and it's not just Jakobshavn. Almost every one of those big outlet glaciers is doing this. So a big part of this is that warm sea surface temperatures are undermining these big ice tongues, eroding them. Those ice tongues disappear, and when they disappear, the ice from inland has no cork stopping it, and it just flows out into the ocean. This is also happening on the Antarctic Peninsula. If you've been paying attention, there's a big crack in the Larsen Sea ice shelf that's growing by the day. There's all these images of it, but we expect that ice sheet to disappear in the not-too-distant future, and then those glaciers that are behind it will flow down into the ocean. So the breaking up of the ice shelf doesn't change sea level rise, but when you get rid of it and all that ice flows inland out into the ocean, that contributes to sea level rise. So that's a really big challenge. This is another graph related to sea level rise. This is global sea level rise as measured from satellites, the TOPEX and JASON series of satellites. We put those up in 1993, so through 2016. And you can see the long-term trend is this number, 3.4 millimeters per year. That's essentially a doubling of the rate of sea level rise compared to the last century. So we're beginning to see this increase in the rate of sea level rise that's driven both by increasing temperatures, which make ocean water less dense, so it takes up more volume, but also driven by the fact that we're taking ice from the continents and pouring it into the ocean. All right, so that's sort of the intro to global sea level rise. Now, everything else I'm going to talk about is based on New England. All of the graphs and data I'm going to show you come from a whole series of reports that I've written along with my colleagues, and they're all available at Climate Solutions New England, NE, Climate Solutions NE.org, or if you want these and you can't find the website, feel free to email me. But so most of this information is out there. I can also send you the peer-reviewed publications that it's predicated on. So what we did, not an ice core study, but a paleo study, is we said, well, how is climate change in New England? I can't drill an ice core here, but I can go back and get a bunch of instrumental data. And the fine people at NOAA, the National Climatic Data Center, have assembled the best available data. So everything I'm showing you comes from these stations called the U.S. Historical Climatology Network. They're our best meteorological stations. So I forget now, I did this a few years ago, but across New England we had something like, 150 temperature stations and probably 200 for precipitation. So lots of data goes into this. So here's the average annual minimum temperature from 1895 to 2012. And I'm showing you this because this is the rate of change in temperature that we see that's the greatest. We've seen the greatest increase in temperature in minimum temperatures, which means our night times are warming up more than any other time period, right? It's not daytime temperatures, it's nighttime temperatures. And you can see that there's kind of this change around 1970. We begin to see this increase. You can also look at precipitation. So we have daily precipitation measurements. So you can see here that there really isn't that much change. You might argue that there's been this increase in precipitation in the last few years. I'd be pretty careful about that. But so maybe we're getting a little bit wetter. We're getting warmer and a little bit wetter. But there hasn't been a huge change in precipitation. The one thing that you really notice on this figure, and I would argue that most of you were not alive back here, but 1965 was the last time we had a really big drought, much bigger than the drought that we just went through. In fact, if you look at this metric called the Palmer Drought Index, you'll see that we had an index of sort of around 4 to 5, which means it was a really significant drought. And in fact, you can go back and read about this, and there were New York City and New England was having a water war because New York City wanted our water. It was a pretty big deal. And we haven't suffered. We had one in 2001. This ends in 2012. I suspect this year's would be sort of somewhere up here. An important drought, but not as bad as 1965. All right, so I know this is like the table from hell, but I just wanted to highlight. You can get all this information in those reports or online, but we actually broke it down. Maximum temperature, minimum temperature, length of the growing season, precipitation, all kinds of indicators of change. And what I want to show you is that by far the biggest change we're seeing is in our wintertime temperatures, right? Minimum wintertime temperatures. So we're looking at 1.22 degrees Fahrenheit warming per decade over the last 50 years. 6 degrees of Fahrenheit warming over 50 years. Right? That's an incredible rate of change. And you might not have noticed this, but I have, because winters here are way different than they were when I was a kid. We're also seeing that in snow-covered days. We're increasing the number of snow-covered days about 5 per decade. So we've decreased the number of snow-covered days by about a month over the course of 50 years. So very, very clear. We also do these actually for every one of those meteorological stations. So if you're interested to know how climate's changed in your hometown, we have all those records available on our webpage. Here's a very different way to look at climate change, and perhaps this speaks to the one of the goals of the interdisciplinary nature of what we're trying to get at. But here I've gone and collected how much money FEMA has given different states in New England for presidentially declared disasters and emergencies. So I would argue that there's a real difference. You can't get a lot of data before 1999 because they changed the way they did things. But from 1999 to 2004, we never really asked for a lot of money across New England. But we had big floods in New Hampshire and Alston in 2005, 2006, Mother's Day, 2007, Patriots Day. Irene is the big winner here, right? Almost, well, 70 to 80% of all this money is for floods across New England. And you can see that there's just a real change. We're asking for a lot more money, and we're asking for it much more frequently. So that's not just a change in our precipitation. It's also been, I didn't show you that plot. Where's my precipitation plot? Well, I'm just going to tell you that while the overall precipitation hasn't changed, the number of really big storms has increased dramatically. So we get more of our rain and fewer events. So we looked at a whole range of ways you can look at that. Look at the biggest storms, those that drop 4 inches of precipitation, and they have doubled or tripled, or in some cases increased by a factor of 10 across New England. So we have bigger precipitation storms that drop more rain, and we've also paved a lot of surfaces in our ecosystem, in our watersheds, over the course of the past 50 years across New England. You combine those two and you end up with more flooding, and that's really reflected in the amount of money that we ask for from the federal government. If we look offshore, this is a really kind of shocking trend that has nothing to do with this data set, but Andy Pershing from the Gulf of Maine Institute up in Portland published this research in Science magazine. The Gulf of Maine is the body of water in the ocean that is increasing in temperature the quickest around the globe. Right? So the blue is the, what's blue? So blue is daily, the dots are annual, and then you see the long-term trend, a slight warming, but the rate of that warming has really increased over the course of the past few years. And there's a whole complex set of reasons that are related to ocean circulation for why this is happening, but this really places the marine ecosystem at risk. So you think about cod, for example. They like, especially juvenile cod, like cold waters. They don't have those cold waters, right? It's hard to imagine how you have juvenile cod survive. They've moved northward to the Gulf of Maine, right? Sort of, you can't catch them really in off the coast of Delaware or New Jersey anymore. But you know, the cod fisheries are in trouble. It's been kind of good for lobsters in the short term, but if we continue to warm, right, lobsters like cold water. They don't like really cold water, so the warming's been good, but we could shift out of that ecosystem in a while. All right, everybody take a deep breath. It's all going to be okay, right? I told you you're all going to survive climate change. Go ahead. All right, I want to switch gears a little bit and just talk a little bit about public perception on the issue of climate change. So one of the things I've done is I've begun to work more with a sociologist at the University of New Hampshire, Larry Hamilton, who does a lot of survey work around the issue of climate change. So first in the nation, state, right, in terms of primaries, we're good at surveying. So one of the things our survey center does is we do the Granite State Poll four times a year. So we ask a whole suite of questions, and Larry, and in this case, Larry and I, added some additional questions on that Granite State Poll that asked about issues related to climate change, and in this case, particularly about flooding. So this is a really well-done poll of 500 respondents randomized across New Hampshire, and he's been doing this for, I want to say, 7 to 8 years. So we're talking about thousands and thousands of responses. So these results are really robust. So here, I hope you know this already, but this is another way to prove this to you, that conservatives tend not to believe that humans are changing climate change, while liberals believe that humans are changing climate change. So you can do this nationally or by state. This is a different way to plot those. But what he's plotting here is the percent of the county that voted for Barack Obama in 2012 easy to get data because we actually have to count those. And then this is the survey responses is, are humans causing the climate to change? And so those communities that voted less for Barack Obama, right, have a much lower percentage of people think that humans are driving climate change, whereas those that voted a higher percentage voted for Barack Obama, right, so liberals, conservatives, have a stronger belief that humans are driving climate change. So we have this ideological divide, and you know there's lots of other results I could show you, but essentially climate change is a bigger wedge issue than any other issue. Gay marriage, abortions, women's rights, climate change is the biggest wedge issue, and that comes out time and again in these polls. All right, so I had this crazy hypothesis that if you have experienced a flood, if you have lived through a flood, and I've just told you that flooding has increased across New England, but especially across New Hampshire, that you would actually have a better understanding of the link between flooding and climate change. So that was our hypothesis going in. So I just want to show you, we looked at a bunch of newspaper reports. You can see, right, way more reporting about floods, either floods that have happened or flood policy. This is newspaper reports down here. That's the federal expenditures on disaster in New Hampshire, 75% of which are flooding. So I hope you can see that flooding has increased in New Hampshire. So we asked, and here's the discharge record from the Lamprey River. So that's a small watershed in southeastern New Hampshire. You can see we had a big flood in 1987, but then we had a whole series of floods after that. Arguably, floods have increased dramatically. You know, massive loss of property, loss of life. When you look at, that's just the Lamprey River, when you look across all of New Hampshire, and you look at the top 1% of discharges, sort of the number of times that happened that we had the discharges topping 1%, you can see the period from 2005 to 2014, we have higher discharges, right, that lead to more flooding. So objectively, and even through newspaper reporting, we can show that flooding has increased in New Hampshire. So then we asked, as part of this Granite State poll, you can see that question in A, past decade, have the number and size of destructive floods in New Hampshire changed? So have they increased, are they the same, and have they decreased? So 35% say that they've increased, 38% say they're the same, 6% say they've decreased, and 20% say they don't know. So despite the objective evidence, less than half of the respondents think that flooding has changed. Then we ask this other question, which actually connects to a climate change, right? Do you expect the floods to increase, the number and size of destructive floods in New Hampshire to increase over the next 1 to 2 decades? And so you can see increase, the same, right, about the same numbers, decrease, don't know. But kind of less than half are getting it right. Because we actually, I'll show you the projections. And this is just another measure of how precipitation has changed. We see more extreme precipitation events. So this was shocking to me. I didn't expect this result at all. I expected people to know that flooding had increased because it was in the papers and their neighbors had experienced it. So what's really interesting is when you break this down by ideology. So the same questions, right? That first question, New Hampshire flooding has increased over the past 10 years. If you're a liberal, right? So, you know, you do better. You get a 48% of the time. Moderate liberal, 41%. If you're conservative, 22%. So you can see there's a pretty big difference between liberals and conservatives. Will New Hampshire flight increase over the next few decades? You can see that there's a much bigger separation, right? About 40 points difference between liberals and conservatives. And then this is another one of the questions that Larry asked. Is climate change happening now caused mainly by human activities? You can see that you get essentially the same difference between liberals and conservatives, right? This big ideological divide. This, their interpretation of the climate change question is informing their results on the flooding question. So it's somewhat shocking that their personal experience is not driving their answers, but their ideology is driving their answers. And then last but not least, you can look at sort of the level of education, because we ask a lot of different questions on this poll. And so you can see probability that flood's likely to increase by education and ideology. So this is the future climate question. So if you're a liberal and you have more education, you actually sort of go from probability of 0.5 or 50% up to about 0.7. So as you become more educated, you believe that there's going to be more floods in the future. Just go down here to not moderately conservative, but very conservative. The more educated you get, right, the more you think that floods are not going to increase in the future. So this is the huge challenge that this country faces around this issue. Right? The more educated you are as a conservative, the more you believe that your perspective is right. And there's a lot of, maybe the psychology students can help me out here, but you know, one of the reasons here is that essentially these individuals are likely getting their information from a set of messengers that they are trusted messengers, and so there's this whole notion of bias assimilation. They're only assimilating information in that they want to hear, and as they know more about that topic, they're filtering that information even more. But this is a huge challenge, because we can't solve this problem with just liberals thinking that it's the problem. We actually have to figure out how to get over this divide. All right, that's my little foray into social science. I hope you understood those. So let's back out a couple of other climate change records across New England. There's this great record of ice out dates across the region. I'm particularly interested in this because I love to play pond hockey. Here's my little pond hockey crew. We're called the Climate Change Crew. This is up in Meredith for the Pond Hockey Classic, and we never win, let's just be clear about that. But we have a lot of fun. But so we've been measuring these ice out dates, different criteria on different lakes. But you can see in Lake Winnipesaukee, again, right around 1970, we began to have earlier and earlier ice out dates by about sort of a week to 10 days, and the same on Lake Sunapee. And when you look across the 28 lakes that we have these records for across New England, they almost all show this change. So we're seeing warmer winters, and we're seeing the impacts of those winters with less ice. And you guys, I'm sure, at least those of you who are studying ecosystems, know that there's a really big difference in ecosystems, whether they're ice covered or whether they're not. All right. So hopefully I've shown you that we're seeing significant climate change across New England. And the obvious question is, how is climate going to change in the future? So this turns out to be really challenging, and actually comes back to part of the discussion we had in class today, is about how do you forecast what social systems are going to do. So what is our economy going to be like, not 10 years from now, 20 years from now, but 30 or 40 or 50 or 80 years from now? It is an almost impossible question to answer with any degree of confidence. So what scientists have done, instead of trying to project that, is develop a suite of scenarios, which are essentially plausible storylines on how our economy might change in the future, not how it will change. It's not a prediction. It's a projection. And so I've simplified this graph. These come from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. There's usually about 10 to 12 different scenarios, but I've just changed them. I've just shown you a low emissions and a high emissions scenario. So here we are going from the present up to 2100. These are global emissions of greenhouse gases by year. And there's a high emissions scenario where population grows to about 9 billion by the middle of the century, but we continue to rely upon fossil fuels for our energy, and our emissions just continue to rise. And that gets us to about 1,000 parts per million by volume carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Conversely, this other scenario, same population, socioeconomic scenario, but this is a world where we actually invest in energy efficiency and renewable technologies and preserve our ecosystems and change our diets. so that we can begin to flatten our emissions by the middle of the century and then cause them to decline. And that results in carbon dioxide concentrations of about 450 parts per million by volume. So this is where we're going, and this is where we need to be. And then what, not what I've done, but what climate modelers, they use these as drivers for these tools called global climate models that recreate the Earth system, and then we see how our climate has changed in the future. So this is sort of an ongoing experiment. It happens every 5 years as part of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. These results are from 2007. By the end of this summer, we'll have all the new sort of 2013 results out. But one of the things me and my colleagues do is we downscale those big grid cells to much smaller grid cells, and we actually test this based on all that meteorological data we've collected. We develop statistical relationships between the big cell and all the stations, so we figure out how climate might change on a much finer spatial scale across the region. All right, so all these graphs are how do we, you know, what's high emissions versus low emissions. So the red is the high emissions, the blue is the low emissions. So under a high emissions scenario, we expect our maximum summertime temperatures to increase on the order of 10 to 12 degrees Fahrenheit, average maximum temperature. So you take the maximum temperature, you average it over the summer. What's that average maximum temperature? So we expect that to go up by 10 to 12 degrees Fahrenheit by the end of the century compared to current levels. Conversely, under the low emission scenario, you know, we expect that to level out at sort of an additional 2 to 4 degrees warming. One thing that's really important here is that there's no difference at 2050 between the high emissions and the low emissions scenario. That is the amount of warming that we have already committed to. That is an amount of warming that we need to adapt to. So it's like, let's not talk about it a lot more, let's just start doing it. That's the world we're going to be in, no matter what. There's some variability around these, right? Is it going to be 4 or 3 or 2? But it's going to be a warmer world. But there is a difference, right, by the time you get to the end of the century. So, what does that actually mean in terms of, let's say, heat waves? So heat waves are defined by usually 3 days in a row greater than 9 degrees Fahrenheit. So we've just used that 9 degrees Fahrenheit measure. How many days are going to be above 9 degrees Fahrenheit? On average, across all of New England, we have about 5 of those, right? Fewer in Maine, more in Connecticut. By the end of the century, under the high emission scenario, we'd expect sort of 40 to 45 of those. So essentially, like two-thirds of the summer across New England would be a heat wave. There'd be probably about 70 days down in Connecticut, probably about 35 days in this part of Maine under the high emission scenario. Under the low emission scenario, we'd see much less than that. This place is like New Hampshire. This climate in New Hampshire would be something to the equivalent of what currently exists in North Carolina. So air conditioning all the time. This in New Hampshire is sort of around what is currently in Washington, D.C. So that's what is going to happen, and that's what could happen, depending on what our emissions are in the future. This is another way to look at this, instead of that bar graph, actually a map of what it would look like in the future. So here's, right, the historical. You can see we're sort of 0 to 10, maybe a few more around Boston, 10 to 20. Under the low emission scenario, you see this slight increase. But under the high emission scenario, you essentially see, right, this bullseye pattern around Boston, where we're getting greater than 70 days. Right? It's not horrible in Maine, but it's a big change from less than 10 to 30 days per year. Quite a different story for changes in precipitation. Right? No difference between the low emissions and the high emission scenario. If there's any silver lining to climate change, and I'm not a big believer in silver linings, I think there's a lot of challenges, but New England is going to have water. We're going to have fresh water in the future, right? That's probably not going to happen for California and Colorado and New Mexico and Utah. They're going to have in the Midwest, right? They've been through a big drought. They're out of it now. They're likely to go back into one. They're going to face huge challenges around water, but we're going to have water. And if it isn't already our most precious resource, it's likely to become our most precious resource. And we probably want to start thinking about how we preserve more of that water than we do right now. One of the challenges is that we're going to see this trend that's continued of more precipitation in fewer events, so more big precipitation events. So across New England, over this period, we sort of had about 4 of those 4-inch precipitation events per decade. And by the end of the century, you know, we expect to see a doubling or a tripling of that, right? Given that these are really extreme precipitation events, there's not a lot of difference between those two columns there, but we're going to see an increase. And so I would argue we might want to think about how we develop our land and make it pervious instead of making it impervious cover so that we can reduce flooding. All right, if that wasn't enough, we're also continuing to see sea levels rise. So I told you, right, 3.4 millimeters per year. As we go out in the future, there's a range of different projections on how much sea level is going to rise. So this comes from the National Climate Assessment. And as you look at this, the question I think you need to ask yourself is, why is there such a big range, right? So if we look at the 2050, we can see the estimates, right? We're not on this linear trend. We're on this exponentially increasing trend because of what's happening in Greenland and Antarctica. So the low estimate is up around 0.6 feet. The high estimate is around 2 feet of sea level rise by 2050. And then you get up to 2100, it's sort of 1.6 feet to 6.6 feet, right? There's a huge range there. And the reason there's such a large range is we're not very good at predicting what's going to happen with Greenland and Antarctica. The advice that we've given to the Coastal Risk and Hazards Commission in New Hampshire is to say that for anything that you have a very low risk tolerance for, you should start preparing for 4 feet of sea level rise and be ready to accommodate 6.6 feet of sea level rise, which might be something you want to think about your new student center, because I don't think that you want to rebuild that in the next 50 years. So how much sea level rise can that new building accommodate? I've asked the question a couple times. Still don't have an answer. So this is a really big challenge for society on how we deal with this really big range, but we have to start thinking about it. The other piece is that this is not going to end at 2100, right? Sea levels are going to keep going up for the next several centuries, likely on the order of 20 to 30 to 40 feet, which is going to mean a very different place 100 or 200 years from now. And I can tell you, if you want to spark a lot of debate in any conversation, start asking people about, are they interested in relocating from the coast? And you can Google me and Cameron Wake in real estate, and you can see how poorly I answered that question in the media. I'll guarantee you it will be my number one hit on what comes up. I suggest that people in the south end of Portsmouth might want to sell their homes. And real estate agents got really, really upset at me. And I would argue it's still good advice. But Portsmouth really has quite a bit of vulnerability. All right. How are we doing? We have till 6. You guys probably want to get on the road. I got a few more. Probably about 5 more minutes. So what are the solutions? We heard about this from Jim today. There's this notion of mitigation, reducing greenhouse gas emissions, or maybe even figuring out how we suck carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and bury it in the crust. And there's adapting to the climate change that's inevitable. These are not separate. These are fundamentally one and the same. The most important adaptation strategy is reducing the amount of climate change that we have to adapt to, which we do by reducing our greenhouse gas emissions, right? Number one adaptation strategy is reducing how much we have to adapt to. So these two really go hand in hand. I told you already, I think climate change is the innovation opportunity for the 21st century. I think we need innovation across a whole range of sectors. And then if I had to pick sort of 5 things that we need to do, none of which are simple at all, but these are things I think that have to happen in order for us to succeed. We need to get a price on carbon. I'll talk a little bit about that. We need to better promote energy efficiency and renewables. Keeping those ecosystems that currently provide us with fundamental services like clean water and oxygen and soil and food and timber and flood mitigation and places to recreate and a sense of being, I think is critical. I won't talk a lot about it, but a lot of people ask me about this, and I think it's really important to transition to a lower carbon food system, which really means, in a really short phrase, is eat less beef. And then we're going to have to adapt to unavoidable climate change. All right, so the price on carbon. For a long time, it's been sort of something I would say that liberals and Democrats have promoted, but it's something that has been picked up by different groups of conservatives. And I think it's very important. It is very much a libertarian idea in that you're asking people to pay for the damage they're creating by emitting carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. So this was a report that came out less than a month ago from 8 conservative thinking leaders. And that quote in the upper right-hand corner is really important. So James Baker III says the risk is sufficiently strong that we need an insurance policy. So the thinking goes that you might believe that there's going to be a lot of climate change, and you might not believe there's going to be a lot of climate change. So how big is the risk, right? That's essentially the question of climate change in the future. And that these conservatives are saying the risk is big enough that we need an insurance policy. So even if you don't believe in it, you have to acknowledge there's a risk. So the analogy I can give you is that if you own a home, your parents own a home, I can be pretty sure almost all of you have fire insurance for a fire. There is an extremely low probability that your house will be burned down. Knock on wood, we don't want anybody to suffer that, right? But we all have fire insurance. Why? Because the risk of a catastrophic event exists. So we buy insurance for it. So what the conservatives are saying is we need that same insurance policy for the climate system. And capitalism understands how to value risk. So let's think about putting a value on it and doing something about it. And that essentially is a carbon tax. And a carbon tax begins essentially to drive our system towards energy efficiency and renewables. And we need that big hammer because that's how we're going to change behavior. Because it's really hard to change human behavior without clear market signals. So their tax on carbon emissions is going to be about $40 a ton, which many of us would argue is way too low. But I love that this is a conservative plan. That money that was raised would not be used to grow government. It would be given back to the American people. There'd be this border adjustment, so material or goods and services that came into the country that had a high carbon content would be paid for. And this is sort of the wonderful aspect of this for any conservative is they have the carbon tax, you get to get rid of a whole suite of regulations, especially the Clean Power Plan, which a lot of Republicans really despise and which is likely being dismantled as we speak. So a couple of other things. I've been looking at this and just published a brief on this a couple of days ago. How is it that we can begin? So are we making progress? Let's put it that way. Here's our US gross domestic product. You can see that's been increasing. But ever since 2006, right, we have been decreasing our energy consumption. We're decoupling economic growth from energy consumption, which is brand new. Historically, energy and economies grew together. Now we're beginning to decouple that. If you look at New England, we're even doing better than what the nation is doing. We're growing our economy more, and we're reducing our energy use more. So another way you can look at this is look at energy intensity, right? So energy intensity is just the amount of energy used per GDP that your economy produces. There's the US average. There's the five New England states that are doing a really good job. They have an energy intensity that's better than the US average. That means we're more efficient at using energy to produce a dollar of GDP. You can see Maine's not doing so well. Very much an industrial-based economy in Maine, but one that I think we need to do a lot better on. All right, let's skip through my car seat. Another trend that I think is really encouraging is we're beginning to see significant investment in renewable energies. So this is from Carbon Brief, but I think this data actually is from Bloomberg. This is the amount of investment in renewable energy around the globe. We're getting up close to $300 billion per year. There's a variety of reports that suggest we probably, to solve the problem, we really have to get up to $1 trillion. So we need to increase that three times. But there's a lot of money now going into renewable energies. Even more interesting is that every year we look at how much new net generating capacity there is. So this is for electricity. And 2015 marked the first time that more than 50% of that new generating capacity was in renewables, without including large hydro. So renewables without large hydro, 53% of new capacity. So here are the others, coal, gas, large hydro, and nuclear. This is a really big shift. This trend globally occurred in 2016 again. So we've passed the key tipping point. In the US, almost half of the new generating capacity in 2016 was solar. And between solar and wind, two-thirds of new generating capacity was renewable. Right? So we're now on that pathway. And no matter what President Trump says, we're not going back to coal. This, in fact, is the future. So that's kind of encouraging. I just wanted to share, I've done a lot of work with the New Hampshire Coastal Risks and Hazards Commission, and I put this up because it's been really very fascinating for me to engage in a body that was established by the New Hampshire legislature to provide them with science to drive better decision making. And I'll end up talking about why I think this is important. But this has been a really valuable experience for me. So we've just written a report, 35 recommendations on how our municipalities and our state Department of Transportation and Environmental Services can actually begin to think about doing something about rising sea levels. And I can tell you, 37 members on this commission, I was one of them. Most of them were from municipalities. Republicans, Democrats, liberals, conservatives, we unanimously accepted all 35 recommendations. Right? In a world where it's dominated by bipartisanship, this was actually a show that we can sit down and work together and solve problems if we decide to. So there you go. It's done now. We finished our report. I won't talk about that. Understanding what we need to do, I think this is a framework for action, but these are really solid. This is a really solid approach to the problem. So it's not about going out and spending a whole bunch of money right now. It's really about taking an incremental approach and planning and figuring out how it is you can build resilience in your communities over time. So acting early is important, but don't act for a problem that's in 2100. Act for a problem that you're facing already. We already flood in coastal New Hampshire. You already flood in coastal Maine. We can begin to deal with those issues. Respond incrementally, especially as more science come in. Totally revisit and revise, right? Always go back to the science and see what's coming up. Collaborate across a range of different institutions. Incorporate risk tolerance in design. That's sort of that example I gave you, is that if you have a low risk for a low tolerance for risk, like a wastewater treatment plant or a bridge or a nuclear power plant, you better take extra effort to make sure that you're protecting that. And make no regrets decisions. Do things that make sense, even if sea level rise is not going to go up, based on the current conditions that you're experiencing. I'll pass through that. All right. This usually gets up. I thought you might like this because I saw the flag in here. So I just want to end up by talking about, briefly, about what is the role of academia in this challenge. So I would say for, I don't know, I hope the historians don't pick on me too much, but for many decades, if not a century, the academy has really had the luxury of doing what it thought was important. Right? We're doing the research, that research questions that were raised by scientists, that were discussed by scientists, that were shared in the peer-reviewed published literature, and that we focused on sort of some fundamental questions about the nature of the Earth or human beings. So I think that was a golden period. I just don't think that's any longer that's enough. Right? I still think that there is a need for a whole bunch of basic research, but I also think that a whole bunch of us need to step up to the plate and figure out how it is we can help society solve this problem. And I would argue that, at least from a climate scientist perspective, that I should be at the table when key decisions are being made about big infrastructure projects, about how we might go about taxing people in the future. Not because I don't want to tell people what to do, but because they should at least listen to the advice that I give on dealing with the climate system. So this is not a small conversation in academia, because for so long, like, we bear the mantle of we're objective, we're not advocates, we don't get involved in policy issues. So I think that we're seeing a revolution actually right now, as many more scientists realize that they need to get engaged, not only to protect science, to protect research dollars, there's some self-interest there, but really help society move forward in what is arguably the most significant grand challenge that we face. And I have no doubt if we're engaged, if you're engaged, that we will get to that answer sooner and we will get to a better answer than if you're not engaged. So I'll stop there and I'll be happy to answer any of your questions. Yes.
React different ways to different images. You know, they evoke certain responses. Do you think that there's maybe not one of the or images that could be used from those issues Is there one that you would think more so than the others that would evoke responses from people who have trouble with the anthropogenic climate change concept? Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Were you at Jim's lecture today?
No, I was not. I couldn't make it.
So he actually showed an image that, like, I have seen, and I probably have. I have several examples of it, but I've never put them together. And it's the blue marble in space, and then it's the burning earth. So it's the blue marble, and then it's like a computer-generated image of the earth, of how much warmer the earth is going to be in the future. And I really thought that was a powerful image. He also talked, sort of walked us through a series of cartoons that can be really powerful. And I could recommend Michael Mann, who's a really famous climatologist. He developed the hockey stick graph. He just wrote a book with Tom Tolles where he talks about the challenges that we face, that's illustrated with a whole bunch of comics that are really insightful. So, but I guess I really want to say is I don't think an image is enough, and I don't think more data is the answer. I think we have to get into a discussion of values and norms. I think that's much more important. As a scientist, we need to understand that people have different perspectives, that it's not all about the data. And so, you know, in part, that's why I really like this conservative effort at a carbon tax. A lot of liberals don't like it because the liberals want the money to be invested in clean energy. And my advice to liberals is, listen, it's a great conservative idea. Your idea is not going to work right now. So support the idea that actually goes to solving the problem. And the big issue is not that the carbon tax raises money. The big issue is that it sends a signal that you should invest in renewable energy. So I appreciate your question, but I don't think the image is going to be enough. You know, and maybe it was, you know, the polar bear. But even the image of, you know, the tragic image of that Syrian boy on the beach, it moved us all, and then nothing changed. So I think we need more than an image, but great question.
So great talk, very interesting. I have two questions. One is like a little curiosity. So in the carbon temperature graph, right, like the carbon spikes up and then goes back down. I'm just curious, like, what's that process where it comes out of the atmosphere?
Right, so the it's actually been really difficult to model. But the basic physics are that cold water absorbs far more carbon dioxide than warm water does. So think about your warm soda. If it's warm, you shake it up, give it to your friend. So carbon dioxide comes out of warm water. So there's a feedback loop in that we change the temperature because you change the Earth's orbit, and then you begin to change the temperature of the ocean, and there's a positive feedback loop. If it begins to get colder, you suck carbon out of the atmosphere. As you suck carbon out of the atmosphere, it gets colder, right? So there's a positive feedback loop there, and then vice versa. So it's really the solubility of carbon dioxide in water that drives that increase and decrease, and then the feedback that causes on the climate system.
So I did have like a more substantive question, and this is like a friendly question from somebody who agrees with everything said. But so you have somebody like you on the board, right, who agrees with the science, right? But he has maybe the same goal, right? He wants to make people's lives better, right? He wants to improve people's lives, but he thinks that the way to achieve that is not through like mitigating carbon emissions, right? But it's economic development. So he thinks that if we respond to climate change, then what's going to happen? We're going to give so much economic development that we don't make people's lives better off. So I sort of tend towards like mitigation, but like what do we say to somebody like Bumbo who says we give up on social development?
So great question, and happy that you asked it. So let me see how best to answer this. So I think I would put Bjorn in the realm of climate deniers, kind of, because the transition that we've seen is that essentially what he's saying is that the risk of climate change is pretty low. Big climate change is pretty low. So he's at the beginning acknowledging or assuming that there's not going to be that much climate change to adapt to. It's the only way his argument works. If he takes the high range of sea level rise or the high range of temperature increase or the high range of the increase in fires or the high range of the loss of ocean ecosystems, his argument doesn't work. So he's sort of making an argument based on skinny tails instead of fat tails, based on the distribution of the risk. So back to the fire example, right? He really doesn't think that there's really much chance at all of your house ever burning down. So why buy the insurance? Let's just deal with it if it happens. So that's one part. So he's, I would argue from a climate science perspective, is he's significantly underestimating the amount of climate change that could happen. And I can tell you that the climate science community hasn't done a great job on this, because every 2 or 3 years we say, well, actually, we kind of lowballed that last estimate. We think it's going to get warmer than we said 3 years ago. And we think there's going to be more sea level rise than there was 3 years ago. So if you look at the progression of the IPCCs, you see that the amount of climate change that we're projecting to happen is increasing over time. So the risk is increasing. Then the second part of that is that I just don't buy the argument that reducing greenhouse gas emissions costs money. There's investment that has to go into it. But right now, solar panels and wind cost less than building a coal-fired power plant or even a natural gas-fired power plant. So one of the reasons I'm optimistic is that the solutions to reducing our greenhouse gas emissions are actually aligning with our capitalist system, and the prices are coming way down to the point that we don't really need to subsidize solar panels anymore because they're equivalent. So this idea that reducing greenhouse gas emissions is going to be bad for the economy is actually incorrect. So one of the statistics I didn't share was that in the solar industry alone today, there's twice as many jobs as there are in coal and oil and natural gas combined. So actually, transitioning our system can be the next big economic driver to raise people out of poverty around the world. So I just don't buy the argument that you have to do something else for economic development. Do the renewable energy. That's the economic development that buys you the insurance policy and grows the economy at the same time. And he really gets under my skin because he's kind of a pseudoscientist, right? He hasn't written anything on this topic in a decade. He doesn't publish. He seeks attention for, I think, a framework that is not well supported by research, which is how he presents himself. Excellent question. We could go on forever on that front. Yes?
You mentioned, and moved very quickly through the change of diet question, that you suggested as a just to reduce the global footprint of our, or rather global footprint of our food systems. But it's a multidimensional problem. I'm sure you know more about that, and I'm wondering how many people even are aware of. So if you could say more about more details about how we do need to change and how we can control.
So this is an area that I don't do a lot of research on, so it's more sort of vignettes of what I know from other people. But essentially, when you raise beef, you need a lot of land, you need to give them feed, and because of their anaerobic digestive systems, they burp a lot of methane. And so they're methane producers. And so you can sort of look at other large livestock raising the amount of energy you need to raise lots of livestock, and the energy inputs are significantly larger than than to raise vegetables. There has been a lot of talk about food miles, but it turns out there's been some research that suggests the food miles aren't nearly as important as what you eat. So what you eat is really important. And you know, I don't even know the numbers, maybe you can help, but sort of 10 to 100 times more greenhouse gas emissions from a red meat heavy diet compared to a vegetarian diet. So couple that with the notion that we're going from 7 billion to 9 billion people, and you clearly understand that it's unsustainable for the world to eat the way we eat now. Climate issues aside, just the amount of energy to grow all that livestock is unsustainable. And so there's a notion, so there's a time when we are going to have to change. And China's going in the exact opposite direction, much more meat-heavy diets. But this notion that it's not all about red meat all the time is something that I think we're just going to have to accept. Personally, we call ourselves flexitarians. We do meatless Mondays, eat a lot less red meat, share it when we eat it, make sure it's from Maine. But it's a pretty big challenge. I will say also, personally, we do this, my wife and I take sort of
4 weeks of cleanse after the holiday season because we eat so much sugar over Christmas, and we never feel better than when we're on a vegetarian diet. And we still go back to meat, but every year we eat a little bit less meat. So I'm sort of doing the experiment, and I think you could be healthier with a vegetarian diet. So I think there's another whole set of issues that actually reinforce themselves. But it's a huge change in behavior that is tremendously challenging.
I have a question similar to Susan's question. So we live close to the ocean, or by the ocean, and we have a large marine science department here, also an agriculture program here. What's your feeling about the capacity of the marine agriculture that we actually can have, and how is that sustainable, and what's the impact on the climate change?
So
that's the one big question. So.
Yeah. So I would argue that aquaculture is one of our ways to the future. You can like it or dislike it, but it is a reality that we have to figure out. I know quite a bit about the open ocean aquaculture we're doing at UNH, which may actually have sort of less impacts because they don't have to sort of give a lot of antibiotics to the fish. They're in the open ocean in really big nets, and we do multi-trophic, so that seems to be working. But I would say we have to figure it out, and probably sooner rather than later. I fear for the significant change in the Gulf of Maine ecosystem because of the warming temperatures and the increase in carbon dioxide. So I don't really know how we get the protein in the future without doing aquaculture. I'm hoping that it can be done better than the way it's been done in the past, and it's caused lots of pollution problems, as well as sort of, you know, fish with lots of antibiotics in them. So I don't know the answers, but I think we have to figure it out. They're probably doing it better than they're doing it in Thailand and Vietnam with shrimp too now. So how do we do it in a fair and equitable way that doesn't pollute our coastlines? But the sooner we figure it out, the better.
Thank you.
One more.
Yeah.
Blame her.
Sorry. So it sounds like you're encouraging or endorsing vegan dividend from your presentation. And, in your opinion, why is that so much better than, say, cap and trade or any other methods of carbon regulation?
The short answer is I like it better because it's politically feasible right now. And I also, I got to tell you, when the Democrats pushed cap and trade, right after the economy collapsed, it's like, why do we want to give big banks another opportunity to make a whole bunch of money on our backs? So I had a visceral reaction to the economic collapse. And so the cap and trade, the fee and dividend is simple, right? You can do it at the top of the economy. It's pretty easy accounting. We shouldn't need a lot of rules and regulations to make it happen. It's a libertarian idea, so I think it has legs. If not right now, maybe after this administration. So I am very much in the realm of what's possible, and I just really appreciate that this is a conservative idea to address a problem where conservatives have not been active before. All right, I hope you all have a fantastic spring break.